this too.
Yeah. Yeah, what you want to
ask? Here. I'm going to lower this.
No. We good. We got it.
All right, good afternoon, members of the media. I'm attorney Biabri Lamar. I'm joined by my client, Nestor Vega, and his family, who are here with us after a very tragic occasion. We believe that this incident that occurred almost 3 years ago here at this hospital standing behind us, Froedtert Memorial Lutheran Hospital, we believe this to be one of the most tragic situations and potentially one of the most egregious situations in which we allege that there's a cover-up that involved a piece of a surgical device that was left inside Mr. Vega for approximately 3.5 months. So I wanna just kinda walk through just some of the facts that led to the lawsuit that we filed earlier today. Back on September of 2020, what we see here is Mr. Vega, who entered into a surgery following a car accident. It was a surgery that in which work was being done on his ankle, and unfortunately there was a surgical drain in the retention of a fragment that resulted from that surgery. Now what occurred is Mr. Vega, he'll explain that he heard a very loud pop. He was conscious during the surgery. I think that's important to note. He had his phone going. You know, he was trying to kind of keep himself distracted while this operation was taking place. There was a loud pop, and what resulted next was individuals, even from the hallway, Froedtert personnel coming into the room after hearing how loud this fragment of the drain breaking inside of Mr. Vega. Mr. Vega observed the doctors, Chad Beck, and his other attending surgeons who were with him, alongside the medical staff, including the physician assistant, who's also named as a party in this lawsuit. All of these individuals heard this pop. It was no mystery that this fragment of this surgical drain was inside Mr. Vega. Mr. Vega observed several members of the faculty, of the personnel, trying to get this object out of him at that time. Unfortunately, they were not successful. Instead of getting an x-ray and setting him up for an immediate surgery thereafter, instead, they tried to act like this situation didn't exist. We believe that there was a coordinated effort to try to hide what took place back on September 2nd of 2020. And this lasted over 3.5 months in which Mr. Vega suffered. Now, I want to be clear. This wasn't one of the circumstances in which, you know, a foreign object is left and the doctor doesn't know about it. This is a situation in which they completely knew, everybody knew, and they made a decision, a calculated decision, instead of taking accountability and potentially having their reputation be at stake. They decided instead to make their patient suffer and act like it didn't happen. There's an old saying that what's done in the dark comes to the light. And today, our lawsuit is shedding light on what took place in this hospital and the many individuals and personnel who acted in what we believe to cover up this foreign object that was left inside of Mr. Vega. Now, I want to be clear that Mr. Vega had many communications, some of which he recorded, which one of the videos were released to the media, of every single person he talked to, telling them, there's an object in my leg. Why don't you set me up for an x-ray and get this out of me? He also asked them many times, this is not going to cause, you know, I want to make sure this doesn't result in an infection. Medical personnel, doctors, part of this lawsuit, we have Froedtert Hospital. We also have 5 doctors. We have a physician assistant. We have all these individuals that we believe all coordinated efforts to try to hide what took place on this day. And that is a very dangerous practice. We have to hold our medical professionals accountable, and we have, and that's what this lawsuit is for. Of course, we want justice for the loss of mobility, the physical disfigurement that he has in his leg. The pictures are very gruesome. I will show you now what is the result of when you don't follow the standard protocols and the standard of care in the medical profession. Now, there was one person on September 2nd who knew that failing to get this object outside of Mr. Vega could result in infection. There was one person, and that one person was none of the Froedtert medical staff. It was none of the many doctors, none of the attending surgeons. The only person that talked about it causing infection was Mr. Vega himself. He told them, I know if you leave this object in me, I don't want it to result in infection. And they said, oh no, it's not gonna do that. If it is left inside of you, it's sterile. It's not gonna cause infection. And trust me, we got the evidence to back it up. This type of standard and this type of infection lasting over 3.5 months, we cannot stand for that standard here in the city of Milwaukee or in this state. So therefore, this lawsuit that we filed today is about accountability, not only for Mr. Vega, but for many of us all and our loved ones. At this time, I will allow Mr. Vega to say a few words just about his journey. I'll give a couple seconds just so that the media can readjust their cameras for Mr. Vega. With that being said, I will now allow Mr. Vega to go ahead and say a few words about this very tragic and troubling experience, not only for the 3.5 months where this fragment was left inside of him, but the last 3 years and how his life has changed thereafter.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. Yeah, it's been a hell of an experience with this hospital and the negligence they have did to ignore the fact that they left that in me. I have been through a lot of stuff, man. It has stopped me from mobility, spending time with my kids, my grandkids. I can't play sports. I can't even sit up a few minutes to take my kids to the movies or wait in line to get them something to drink or something. It's real hard. I go through pain daily, every day. This pain don't go away. It don't. I go through daily with this every day. And, you know, my kids try to help me the most, but my girl's the one that does most everything for me. And I feel that that's not right. You know, they could have took care of this in the right way. I told them and I warned them that I did not want to come back with an infection. And they assured me, you're not going to come back because it's thorough, you know. And I went and came back for an x-ray and whatnot. They still didn't tell me I had the object when I knew it was there at all time. So I've been going through physical therapies twice a week. I usually go 3 times a week. You know, I don't take opiates because I don't believe in that. I'm against opiates, so I don't take opiates. I try to deal with it with as best as I can. And everybody tells me, man, you're a strong man. I don't know how can you deal with this pain, man. And these are doctors telling me this. And, you know, I wonder, man, you know, why God let me, you know, continue with all this much pain. These people got to get held accountable. It's not right practice, and not just me. This is for everybody in the community, too. If they treat me like this, what can they do to your parents, your grandparents, your kids, your grandkids? You know, they're not in good hands. And there was what hurts me the most is that not once even apologized after they knew it was done. You know, after the surgery, when they removed it, they still didn't even apologize. You know, and I'm looking at the person like, my girl asked them, did you know it was there? Yeah, we knew it was there. Did you find it when you found, you did the surgery? Yeah, we found it. And I'm looking at them and they still did not apologize. You know, and it's like, it was a conspiracy for a whole team that did what they did to me. It's unjust. You know, there's no way in hell they should do that to anybody. Anybody.
I want to give you a second to readjust the mics here. And as Mr. Vega has pointed out, I mean, this struggle, you know, this has been 3 years. And the injuries in which he has sustained, he will have a lifetime. He hasn't been able to work. You know, he has permanent disfigurement. And again, this was visible on x-rays. There were two x-rays in which even the x-rays revealed that there was a fragment that was left. But these doctors looked him right in the eye and told him, oh, no, it's not. There's nothing there. It's not going to be any infection. You're all right. Allowing him to suffer for 3.5 months. And that's why we have our lawsuit alleges, you know, not only medical negligence. You know, we understand the medical malpractice happens. Nobody's perfect. But it's when you know. And you can go home and sleep at night knowing that there's a foreign object inside of a person. We have to go ahead and shine light on those type of circumstances. So, again, we've also alleged medical battery. We've also alleged fraud. Because this is not just malpractice, oh, we didn't know it was there. No, you knew it was there, and you made specific statements that were to reassure him, allowing him to continue to suffer. With that, I'm going to allow Mira to go ahead and say a few words.
This has been very difficult for our whole family. It's difficult, you know, seeing him suffer the way he does. It's been difficult having to carry the burden of our whole family on my own. And just the fact that we can't live a really normal life because there's a lot of limitations to what he can do.
And with that, I'll take a few questions. What we know is that it was a plastic. It was a piece of plastic that was broken inside of him. It's a piece of a surgical drain. It was clearly visible on x-rays. Again, Mr. Vega witnessed himself, you know, it going into him, in addition to the medical staff and all those others that heard it. So, I mean, it was something that should have been readily identifiable.
Like an inch long or about how long? About an inch or so?
Yeah, I would say about an inch, inch and a half or so. Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah, we believe it was about an inch into inch and a half or so.
What do you think this happened? What was it? Like if the drain bursting or broke, or what do you think happened?
Well, what our understanding is that at the time that they were looking to remove the drain, they were kind of pulling on it. Again, we questioned whether the protocols and the way in which they were pulling it was adequate, or that they should have engaged in the surgical drain in that way. But in the tugging on it is what caused the surgical drain to break. It was a loud pop that, like, as I mentioned, individuals even outside of the room heard it. And, you know, that was what ultimately remained beside Mr. Vega for 3.5 months.
Sounded like a rubber band, like, because it's rubber. So when he pulled it, I was telling him, wait, watch it, it hurts. Wait, it hurts. He said, okay, well, he tried to wiggle it. He opened it up some more, my wounded, the drainage that I had there, the cast, he opened it more and he tried to pull. And I'm like, watch it, man, it hurts, man. He said, I know, dude, so hold up. And he just snapped it. He just yanked, bah! And I'm, oh, man, what the heck, dude, you just broke it. And he's like, oh, no, it's not broke. And the lady, one of the nurses from my side, she was like, everything's okay, I just hurt that. And I was like, yeah, man, this dude. And then I told my girl, go check the drainage, because I know he broke it. And they tried to say that it was not broken. That's the way they cut it before they do surgery. And I told my girl, get it, take pictures, because I know it's a piece in there. And then what happens? He takes up over 2 hours before he come back to patch me up again. You know, so they, I know what they did. They covered this up. They didn't want to do it. That's all.
What's the long-term prognosis?
I think it's been 3 years at this point. I think he has probably reached the capacity. He is still treating every single week. He's still going to therapy and going to the doctors and, you know, trying to improve. But his ability to be able to walk 100% again, he is able to walk on his cane a little bit in short distances. But if he's going to be up on his feet for long periods of time, he has to now be confined to a wheelchair. So, again, his life is forever changed because of it. You know, we believe that there is still infection. We are in the process of getting him to see more specialists. I will tell you that he was with the defendant hospital treatment under their care for a significant amount of time after this object was left inside of him until we realized that that's probably a conflict. So now, he's already seeing outside providers, and we will continually, seek to get him with other specialists. Right.
And then it was, I guess, it was because of next door who knew that the item was still inside him, that he went to the doctor's and told him that he still had this inside him, and then they took it out?
No, so what ultimately happened, we got to be here. The initial operation was on September 2nd, of 2020. Nestor knew then, as a layperson, outside of all these doctors, he knew that there was an object left inside of him and that object could result in infection. He told them many times. I mean, he's on recording saying that, hey, this can cause an infection. Oh, no, it'll be okay, blah, blah, blah. So ultimately, over the course of the 3.5 months, it got worse. He was going to follow-up visits. His infection was worsening. These medical professionals didn't even want to acknowledge that he had an infection. It wasn't until he had to be rushed to the emergency room on December 13th of 2020, in which the emergency staff said, you know what, there's an object in there. We need to get this out immediately. They're the only ones that followed the standard of care. It was on December 13th after he had already suffered for 2.5 months.
He came back to greater than
December. Yes. So we thank the doctors and emergency staff for doing their job. And unfortunately, his surgical team, who he had complete confidence in, did not. All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you guys for coming.